Yeah. Dear Heavenly Father, we just love you so much, Father. Thank you for the privilege to come here today and to worship you and learn more about you, Father. And Lord, we just pray that you speak to us today and we'd be attentive to what you have us to learn. And we just open our hearts to you, Father, in worship and give you all our love and praise that you rightly deserve. Just love you so much, Father, and pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. This morning, so we are going to share some of our songs that we've done before, so nothing to do that way. If you would stand with us this morning as we press into God's presence. but to focus on you alone, for you are everything.
Yeah.
petitions at your feet. God, we throw our crowns at your feet. Be glorified. You took us here today. Thank you for your presence. In Jesus' name.
See it or not, whether we comprehend it, we definitely don't comprehend it. The reality is when God's people gathers together, or when you as a believer walk in this world with God, that's where heaven and earth come together. Amazing. And all over
some people are 24, well, not quite 24 hours ahead of us. Some people are behind us. But all over the world this day, as the groups gather, the kingdom of God is interacting with the kingdom of the world because God's people come together. That is such a wonderful, that's such a wonderful reality, and I hope that you don't take that for granted. God is here. His Spirit is here. He delights when His people get together. In fact, He asks us to get together, right? And so here we are, and many other people are together, and some of you who are following us online, you know, you're with us. We're all one body in Christ. We're going to continue on with this, the thought, the reality that we're living under the power of God. Last week we talked about our attitudes in living under the power of God, and we talked about how we trusted in God's presence. We have to trust in God's presence. God's presence is really here with us, both individually as well as corporately. And then we also expect for God to provide, for God's power to be manifested. We expect that because it's not about us. It's not about what we do. It's about Him and who He is and what He wants to do in this world. And that's such an incredible thought. That's beyond our comprehension, because why would the God of the universe really care about us? Because He made us. He created us in His image and likeness, and He wants to still flow through us. And then thirdly, that we rest in His sovereignty, that we relax in the fact that our God is sovereign. I don't care what's going on in the world. I don't care what you see going on. Our God is sovereign, and that sovereignty is manifested. Today we're going to continue on with this subject of living in God's power, and we're going to look at Psalms 91. As we look, and the title of the message is Surrounded by God's Power. We are surrounded by God's power. We're going to actually break this psalm up into three different components. And as we go through it, we want to discuss it just a little bit. But before I do, it's really important to understand that probably Moses wrote the psalm. Some people say David, but the psalm previous to this was written by Moses. Psalms 91 doesn't have an author declared in Scripture. So most people, most of the Jewish scholars believe this is one of Moses' psalms. And so it doesn't matter who wrote it. The reality is that it is God's word, and God speaks to us about the fact that His sovereignty surrounds His people. A.W. Tozer made a statement, and it's there on the overhead, and I love this statement that Tozer makes. He says this: We need never shout across the spaces to an absent God. He is nearer than our own soul, closer than our most secret thoughts. In fact, He is even closer than the thoughts that we have that we don't know we have, the beliefs that we have that we're not even aware that we have. God is there, and we don't have to shout at Him. We don't have to think that we have to have a special way to come to Him except through His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Anyways, we're going to look at Psalms 91, and you can follow along in your Scripture if you want. And the first point I want to make comes from the first two verses. It's a declaration of assurance, the assurance of who God is and what God is doing. Let's read verse 1. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. He who dwells, the Hebrew word from dwell comes from the word to sit. He who sits, he who lives in the shelter of the Most High. He will abide, he will rest. It's like you're at home in your seat. This is your place, you're resting there. He will abide under the shelter, under the shadow of the Almighty. You see, all of us believers have a right to live in this space where we dwell in the presence of God, where we dwell in his throne room. Not all believers do that. We come and visit. We think this is kind of like a timeshare vacation. When we have time, we'll go and visit his throne room. Or especially when we're in difficult times, we go to his throne room. But the reality is this psalm is written for those who dwell under the shelter of the Almighty God. And the thing about that, which is wonderful, is this. We are all invited to do that. We're all invited to live there in the presence of the Almighty, to rest there, to relax there. And I have a sense that as we do this more and more, I don't care what the conditions are out there in the world, we, as followers of Jesus, are going to be much more at peace. We're going to walk in integrity. We're going to walk in gentleness in a world that's raging with anger. Doesn't mean that we don't hold certain things to be true, but it means that we don't scream at others with red faces and shake our fists because they don't agree with us. You see, this dwelling place of God is God's dwelling place. It's not man's dwelling place. And when I dwell in God's dwelling place, and when we dwell in God's dwelling place, guess whose reality becomes most important? God's. And then we live that out in this world. Does God hate evil? God absolutely hates evil. The proof is the cross. God hates evil so much, and the captivity that evil put on people, that God died on the cross to free us. The Lord Jesus died on the cross so the Father would forgive us of the captivity of evil and free us from that. But you see, being freed from evil isn't enough. He's also invited us to dwell with him. And that's our right. In fact, Jeremiah, a few years after this, after the Psalms at least, certainly just a few years after Moses wrote it, if Moses in fact wrote it, said this: blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord. Let me read that again. It's from Jeremiah 17, verse 7. Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, whose trust is the Lord. He is like a tree planted by water that sends out its roots by the stream and does not fear when heat comes, for its leaves remain green and it is not anxious in the year of drought, for it does not cease to bear fruit. You see, that's God's intentions for us. Isn't that amazing? That's God's intention for us. He desires to be the protective guard over us in our lives. God delights to take care of his people. See, most of us don't believe that. And I'll tell you the reason why. Most of us are more aware of our own shortcomings, our own faults, and our own sins that we spend our time either hiding from him or ducking from him. We spend our time trying to make things right so somehow we become acceptable to him. And in doing that and in living in that way, which many Christians, especially in the Western world, many of us in the Western world do that, when we do that, we keep our eyes on ourselves and not onto him. And his word is full of the truths that he delights to be that for us. Psalms 147:11. The Lord takes pleasure in those who fear him, in those whose hope is in his steadfast love. The Lord takes pleasure in those who fear him. And the word fear in our English language is not really, does not adequately describe him. He doesn't want us trembling at him like he's going to whack us. But we live in reverence. We live in awe. We live in wonder of him. And the Lord takes delight in those. The Lord takes delight in those who trust and whose hope is in his steadfast love. You see, the challenge of living under God's power is this. We got to get our eyes off of ourselves. I'm never going to get tired of saying that. And part of the reason I'm never going to get tired of saying that is because I've constantly got to say that to myself. Peter, eyes off of yourself and onto God. I like to be that way, but sometimes my heart condemns me. But then God addresses that. He says, but God is greater than your heart. God is greater than your heart. And when we look to him, when our hope is in him, when our hope goes beyond how we are living in this world, but our hope goes on to him, the God who is beyond this world, yet lives in this world through us, through his Spirit. How much easier it is to dwell in the shelter, in the covering of the Most High God. You see, what's really important is this. Our hope and our trust is in a person, Jesus Christ. Our hope and our trust is not in our theology. It's not in our belief. It's not in our paradigm what Christianity should look like. Our hope and our trust is in a person. See, when we look at Christianity, one of the biggest struggles that the world sees is the latitude that Christians have in their belief structure that makes it absolutely confusing to understand what Christianity is about. I do believe that God leads certain people in certain ways, and he gives certain people freedom to do certain things, and others he says, no, I don't want you doing that. I believe that there's variety in the kingdom of heaven. But what I don't believe is that we speak ex cathedra, meaning from the throne of God, from God's voice to our ears through our mouth, and declare things that are absolutely contrary to what God's word says. And I want to say something to us here, because we believe we're right. Right? Would you purposely walk in what was wrong? Would you purposely hold on and commit yourself to that which you don't believe? Of course not. We believe what is right. Take it to God. Take it to God. Because it's not about our moralism. It's not about how good we want to be or try to be. It's about who God is. And sometimes the way God leads is somewhat confusing, isn't it? If you don't believe that, it means you haven't read Scripture. When you read Scripture, we scratch our heads like, God, why did you do that? Or why did you lead in that way? Or how come you did this? Because he is sovereign. And we don't understand the whole picture. But we do know this, that he will never go contrary to his word. So the first thing that the writer of the psalm does is he declares his assurance on God. Those who dwell, those who sit, those who live in the shelter, the covering of the Most High, they will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. And if you're going to rest in the shadow of something, you're going to be pretty close to that thing, right? That's what a shadow is. You're close. And therefore, he will say, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. And one of the things that most of us know is that the more I know God, the less I learn to trust myself, or I trust myself. I let go of self-trust because I'm so screwed up. I look at things that I believed 5-10 years ago with a passion and find that some of those things I've had to let go of because that's not what God has shown me. So let's go on to the second point. The second point is that whoever wrote this psalm affirmed the assurance he had. The first one was a declaration of that assurance. The second point is the affirmation of the assurance. And we're going to read the next 10 verses, beginning at verse 3. For it is He, God, who delivers you from the snare of the trapper. And one thing about a trapper is when trappers set snares, they don't make it obvious, right? Snares are hidden. That's why you can trap. If you make a snare obvious, you're never going to catch anything with it, right? So He is the one who delivers you from the snare of the trapper and from the deadly plague. He will cover you with His feathers. And under His wings, you may seek refuge. His faithfulness, remember, it's His faithfulness, is a shield and a bulwark or a protective wall. It's His faithfulness that protects us. It's not our faithfulness to Him, it's His faithfulness to us. Verse 5, you will not be afraid of the terror by night. If this is true, you will not be afraid of the terror by night or of the arrows that fly by day, of the plagues that stalk in darkness, or of the destruction that lays waste at noon. 1,000 may fall at your side and 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. You will only look on with your eyes and see the punishment of the wicked. For you have made the Lord my refuge, even the Most High, your dwelling place. Not your belief place, but your dwelling place. No evil will befall you, nor will any plague come near your tents. For He, God, will command His angels concerning you to protect you in all your ways. They will bear you up in their hands, that you do not strike your foot against a stone. You will tread upon the lion and cobra, the young lion and the serpent you will trample down. Now, obviously, this is a messianic prophecy. And by the way, Satan knows Scripture real well. And for those of us who want to follow God, oftentimes he uses Scripture to condemn us. This was a Scripture, if you remember, that he used on the Lord Jesus when he tempted the Lord Jesus on the temple. Go ahead and cast yourself down. Because God said he's not going to let your foot slip and fall and stumble. When we read this, I don't know if it strikes you or not, but when we read this, that sounds wonderful. That sounds great. And by the way, this passage of Scripture is one that a certain segment of our believing body uses to make a claim that nothing bad will ever happen to you as a Christian if you trust God enough. You're never going to be sick. You're never going to be hurt. You're not going to experience disasters. And by the way, if you do, it's because you haven't trusted Him enough. Your fault. Your fault. Then there's another segment over here that says, how can this be true? Because we as believers do experience sufferings. We're not immune from cancers and other diseases. We're not immune from the terrors that happen. We're not immune from destructive things that occur in life. We're not immune from disasters. I look at our Chinese brethren. I've been reading quite a bit about them this week because the Chinese government's really cracking down on the home churches, destroying hundreds of them. They want the church to be the voice of the Communist Party. Many of our brothers and sisters are being persecuted in China. Many of them are imprisoned for years. God, how is this word true? How does this word comport with the reality of what your children experience? Let me just say this. We always interpret Scripture with Scripture and understand Scripture as a whole. That doesn't make this Scripture or any Scripture null and void. It means that our understanding of Scripture comes from the whole counsel of God. Let me give you two examples, one from the Old Testament and one from the New Testament. Joseph was a young man who followed God. And he was accused of all kinds of things. He paid the penalty for following God. He suffered under false accusations. He was thrown in prison. He was defamed, spoken wrongly of, sold into slavery by his own family. And yet at the very end, when he met his brothers, remember what he said? He says, "You meant it for evil, but God meant all of this for good." See, God didn't keep Joseph from trouble. He kept Joseph in trouble. While Joseph was going through trouble, he was with Joseph in that trouble, and he was with Joseph through that trouble. Last week we talked about Job, right? And it's like Job's the most righteous man, and yet this most righteous man went through horrendous pain that most of us will never experience. The thing was, God was with him in that. God was with him all the way through that. And God showed him things about himself as a result of that. Let's go to a New Testament example. The Lord Jesus himself, the perfect one. God the Son, the one who did nothing but what he saw his Father doing, the one who spoke nothing but what he saw, heard his Father speak. If anybody went through turmoil, the Lord Jesus himself did, right? But God never left him. God was always there with him. God was with him the whole time. God was working in the situation, thankfully, and God was working through that situation. If he wasn't, we wouldn't be here today. Christianity would be meaningless. See, when we read this psalm, we got to understand it from God's perspective. And the psalm isn't just some willy-nilly, nice, fuzzy little thing to kind of hold our hats on and says nothing bad's going to happen to us as believers. It's saying that who you are, God is always going to protect. Our Chinese brothers and sisters, our North Korean brothers and sisters who are going through suffering we can't even understand, even to the point of losing their life, who they are is protected by God. And we scratch our heads, and the reason we scratch our heads is because we're looking at it from this side, from the shadow lands, as C.S. Lewis said. We're not looking at it from God's side. The only way to understand this is to abide in the presence of God and let him help us understand what this means. Do we suffer? Yet we suffer. Yes, we suffer. Do we go through heartache? Yes, we go through heartache. But no bad thing happens to those who dwell in the presence of God. And Scripture is full of the evidence of that. Almost every single one of the 12 disciples were martyred. Stephen, the first one, believer, follower of Jesus, that was martyred. As stones were hurling down on him, he saw Jesus standing at the right hand of the Father. Standing at the right hand of the Father. Jesus sits at the right hand of the Father. But Stephen saw him standing at the right hand of the Father, like, "I'm ready for you. I'm expecting you." When someone comes and visits your home, or someone comes, a family member comes, do you just stay in your seat and says, "Hi there"? You get up. You get ready to welcome them. Story of the prodigal son. When the prodigal came back, when that sinful son came back, what did the father do? He went running out to him. He didn't sit on his couch and said, "Bring the boy in." God's not like that. We need to see this from God's perspective, because God truly is faithful to his word. God personally delivers those and personally protects those who hide in him. It says we have no fear, no need to fear evil or the appearances of evil. That doesn't mean we don't have a right to be afraid. Doesn't mean we don't have a right to be afraid. But even beyond that fear, God gives a confidence. And if you read about many of the martyrs in the Christian faith throughout history, you see the confidence that they had in the face of what they went through and that they eventually experienced, which was usually burning at the stake, chopping off of the heads, horror things. Yet they didn't fear. Were they afraid of that? I'm sure they were. I'm sure nobody thinks, "Oh, it's going to be great to be here, stuck to this pole and fire burning all around me." And I don't mean to be tacky about that. That's a horrible thing. But God's presence, the presence of God, makes it real that he is there to protect them. We have no fear. And yet we as believers, I think, really need to be pulled up on this in this day and age. We're so afraid of what the world is afraid of. We're so fear of where the world is heading. We're fearful of what our children and grandchildren are going to face after we've been gone. Where's God? Where's God in this? Where's your hope in God? Did God not bring them into this world? Will God not be there as we continue to intercede for them and pray for them and uphold them? Does God care less for them than he does for you? I don't think so. He will command his angels concerning you to protect you in all their ways. We're not going to talk about angels today, but I think sometimes there are places and there are occasions where we ought to talk about angels. Billy Graham has a good book out on angels. The writer of Hebrews, Hebrew 1:14, said this, are they, referring to angels, are they not all ministering spirits sent out to serve for the sake of those who are to inherit salvation? We don't worship angels. We don't focus on angelic beings. We focus on the Lord Jesus because that's the only way we have to know who the Father is. God the Father is unknowable. Jesus, his Son, is very knowable. Read the Gospel. The Gospel will show us about who he is. As we get to know Jesus, we get to know God and live in him. But God himself says that he gives angels as ministering spirits to those of us who are going to inherit salvation. And many of the times, we never speak about that. Many times, we don't even think about that. Many of the times when I hear about it, it's from the kooky fringe of the church that says some of the kookiest things about angels. But God is not kooky. God tells us that angels are here to minister the way they did to the Lord Jesus after he went through the temptation, the way they walked with him. We know this, that we are in Christ Jesus, right? Colossians 3:3, your life is hidden with Christ in God. Christ's life is in us, but our life is in Christ, the right hand of God. Let me explain to you how that works. I can't. I just believe by faith God doesn't lie. And somehow in this whole thing, God says, and I am giving you ministering spirits. I am commanding them to take care of you, to protect you in all your ways. Third point, declaration of assurance, the first two verses, the next 10 verses, affirmation of that assurance, and the third one is the confirmation of that assurance, because here God is speaking. Look at verse 14. Because he has loved me, therefore I will deliver him. I will set him securely on high. Because he has known my name, meaning he is intimate with me. We know each other. He will call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. Not keep him from trouble, but I will be with him in trouble. I will rescue him and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and let him see my salvation. Do you hear a repetition there, a couple words? I will. I will, I will. God has made that commitment. God pledges himself to his children. God pledges himself and his protection for those who are his own. By the way, that is a statement that is so unbelievably beyond our understanding. We're talking about the God of the universe who created everything through the word of his mouth. We're talking about the God who knows every single star in the billions of galaxies that we just speculate exist because there's no way for our minds to be able to imagine that. And yet this God, because he said, let us make man in our image and our likeness, and he made man and woman in his image and likeness to join him and have a relationship with him. This God pledges himself to us. Don't let the fact that you're hearing this from a message on Sunday morning fly over your head. Well, the preacher's got to say something good. No, the preacher needs to say something truthful. Truth is a whole lot more important than good. It is good news. It's wonderful news. It's great news. It's fantastic news. Dwell in him because he has pledged himself to you. Wow. That's amazing, isn't it? That he has pledged himself to you. You see, look at Psalms 46, verse 1. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help, not a distant help, but a very present help. God doesn't sit in heaven and says, oh my, I feel so bad for you. Oh my, that's awful what you're going through. He is there with us. Think back on your lives for a minute. This is your own personal journey. Think back on your lives. Think of the heartaches you've experienced. Think of the heartaches you've experienced because of things that have been done to you. The injustices, the unfairness, the evils that have been directed your way. Think back on your life to the things that have happened to you because you made choices that were ungodly. You made choices that were bad. How those choices not only hurt you, but hurt other people. Think of those things. God knows those things. And he said, in all that, I never left you. I never forsake you. I don't want you living looking at yourself with what is done to you. I don't want you living looking at yourself with what you have done. I want you looking towards me because I am there for you. And as we respond to God and we respond to his love, he loves us, we respond to his love, and he does something on our behalf. Not that he doesn't want to, not because he has to, but because we're open and receptive of that. I really believe in my life that God has done a lot of things for me that I have never seen. I don't know it. I never accepted it from him. I look back sometimes now with a little bit of wisdom. It is just a little bit of wisdom. And think, thank you, God, for not letting that happen. Or thank you, God, for turning me in another direction back there. But at the time, it was very painful. At the time, it was heart-wrenching. At the time, you really wondered whether you want to continue on with life or not. But we, as children of God, know that God responds. We love because he first loved us. 1 John 4:19. Verse 14 of 91 says this, because he has loved me, therefore, and then the six I wills. Fortunately, God doesn't wait for us to come to him before we have a relationship, right? Fortunately, he has a relationship with us, and then we have a response back to him, which allows a relationship to be established. But it is in that response to him. It's in that response of trusting him, that response of dwelling in his presence, that he overflows us with the treasures of heaven. Why? Because we're receptive of it. I am convinced that what limits me from experiencing and knowing and receiving more from God is not God. It's me looking at me and not at him. I'm looking at me, how I should live, how I ought to live, what I did, what I didn't do. Me looking at me, how should I be so other people see me a certain way. And it's all, boom, the eyes kind of go inward toward myself. That's what happens when a person dies. God says, keep your eyes on me. Trust me. Know me. Look at me. Believe me. I will be the one who shelters you. I will be the one who protects you. I have commanded my angels to take care of you. I am the one that's going to oversee you. And because you respond to me, I will what? Deliver. I will set him securely. I will answer. I will be with him in trouble, you in trouble. I will rescue you. I will satisfy you with long life. Those are amazing truths, right? And by the way, I will honor you with long life. Long life on this earth is a blessing, but long life on this earth can also be a real curse. The long life that God's talking about is not a curse. Long life that God is talking about is also an everlasting life. Yeah, it's long here, as long as he wants us here. But whatever length of time he gives us here, he wants it to be full. And then comes the fullness of joy when we come into his presence. Psalms 84:11 says this, "The Lord bestows favor and honor. No good thing does he withhold from those who walk uprightly." And please, when you understand Scripture, don't think of walking uprightly as referring to this. How righteous have you been today? It's not what he talks about. Because if that's the case, the moment your eyes opened, you failed. Well, maybe 2 seconds after you open your eyes up. But you know what I'm saying, right? It's about his faithfulness. I'm walking with my eyes on him. I'm looking at him. An example for me of dwelling in the presence of God, oftentimes a good example of that is marriage. I never forget that I'm married. I may be in India. I may be in Bangladesh. I may be in Europe, as I have been the past, or in a few past years. I never forget the fact that I'm married. I know I'm married. I'm convinced I'm married. I'm committed to continue on that marriage. That's just a settled state. That is an example of what it means to dwell in God. You belong to him. You are his. He is yours. His commitment to you is greater than your commitment to him. You fail, he doesn't. He never wakes up on the wrong side of the bed because he never sleeps. He will always hold you. He will always be honest with you. He's not going to tell white lies to keep you happy. He will always be honest with you, but always for the sake of building you up. Isn't it amazing that we as people right here live in a world where heaven and earth are connected because the Spirit of God lives in our hearts? Isn't that amazing? We also have the opportunity to receive the truths, like in this passage of Scripture, receive the truths that come from heaven to us. And then live that out in a world that desperately needs to see truth and reality. We don't have to convince the world of that. We're just to witness to the world of that. And the ones who receive the witness will follow along and get to know the Lord. The ones who reject the witness, don't spend time trying to convince them. It's not your job. That's the job of the Spirit. What we've got to do is make sure that our hearts are right before God so that we live out the truths, the reality of what he wants us to experience. Isn't this good news? He is for us. He is not against us. He is always for us. He is eternally for us. May we be people who actually receive that. May we be people who place our hope in that. May we be people who understand, God, make real your word to me so that no matter what I face, I hold on to your word because your whole word holds on to me by your Spirit living inside. John Piper is one who talks about the delighting in the Lord, the Lord delighting in us. And he has a quote that's on the overhead. He said this, "The mind was designed not to defend what we want, but to discover what is ultimately true, which should shape our wants and satisfy them more deeply with God. The purpose of the mind is not to rationalize subjective preferences, our own personal preferences, but to recognize objective reality and to help the heart revel in God. Don't you like that? And that's what God wants for us. For us to revel in the reality of who He is. See, trusting God is the safest way to live. Trusting God is the safest place to be. Trusting God, not trusting your belief or understanding of God, but trusting Him, the unseen, unknown God, except He has revealed Himself through the Lord Jesus, and now He reveals Himself through His Spirit in our hearts. That is the one who we trust in. That is the safest place for us to be. In all periods of time, but brothers and sisters, we're living in this period of time. We didn't live 300 years ago. I almost guarantee you, we're not going to be living the way we are right now, 100, 200, 300 years from now. So now's the time to trust God. Now's the time to see the reality of His Word become real to us. Isn't that something you're excited about? Isn't that something you want to see more and more of God living and interacting in your life and flowing through you to a world He loves? Don't you want to live that way? Trust His Word. Talk to each other about this. Let's do what we normally do at the end of a message, which is close our eyes and think about those things, those one or two truths that God has impressed on the Spirit of God has impressed on your heart. Take time to think about those. Interact with Him right now in a few seconds of silence we have before our final closing prayer.
Father, as we try to grasp or revel in the wonder of Your truth that's given in the Psalms, we believe that David stated something that is also true for us, stated in Psalm 16. You make known to me the path of life. In Your presence, there is fullness of joy. At Your right hand, our pleasures forevermore. Because that's what You designed for us. And God, may we be people who are responsive to You. May our hearts take the truths that You've placed upon us. And may they become part of our flesh, part of our blood, part of our reality, so that we can live out those truths in this world that really needs to see You. A world that You passionately love. A world that You placed us in for Your glory. And we thank You that as Your followers, one day we will stand and see Your glory revealed. When the Lord Jesus takes the kingdoms of the earth, after He subjected them and given them to You, and all will be back where You intended for them to be. And thank You that that plan is Your plan. You're working that out. Thank You that we can be part of that plan. And we thank You and praise You in Jesus' name.
Yeah.
joined us today again over the web. Thank you so much for participating with us. And we here wish you God's blessings in the various places you're at. And know that you are beloved greatly by God. Go and have a great week knowing that His face shines on you. The Lord be with you. And we're willing to see you next week.